on Wednesday. He's surrounded by Annette, his children, and local members. And so this evening we'll have a prayer vigil for him in this room at 7 p.m. and every day until his songwa on the 13th of this month, next week. And tomorrow I think the prayer vigil will be at 6 p.m. in the evening. Okay. And lots of other announcements too. On Friday, every Friday in the cafe downstairs at 7 p.m., there is a study and fellowship group. So I think this is... we currently have 15 people, according to the announcement, who regularly attend, and it is a very mixed group. Anyone who's interested should come and contact Joanna Hartle. They're currently studying World Scripture 2. And on Sunday, the 21st of September, the third Sunday of this month, there's going to be a Way of Tradition program starting at Lancaster Gate. So it's an education program for those who want to learn more about what it means to be a unificationist. This will be a monthly program. That's from 4 till 6 p.m. in the cafe. And I think this is for today at 7:30. On the same night of the 21st, Joanna Harter will also be giving her testimony at 7:30 p.m. And we also have an announcement. As I'm sure many of you are aware, there's a really tragic situation in Syria and in the Middle East has been going on for some months. This Islamic fundamentalist group taking over an area the size of Britain, and they're persecuting many people there, beheading people of different faiths, different religions. And so there's a human rights event near Westminster, right? Opposite Downing Street, there's a demand a safe haven to protect minorities in Iraq, and that's particularly the Christian minority there. Many people are fleeing the Yazidis, who've been receiving a lot of coverage in the news, and I think Shiites and many Sunnis as well, Muslims, being persecuted as well. So last announcement, or sort of. Not really an announcement as such, but we're going to watch the harp workshop video from the summer. Something to put a... Oh, the reading. Should I do that at the end of it? Yeah, I'll do that at the end. So we'll watch this sort of nice video I think Joanna Jubb made. So it's from the summer harp workshop in Cleve House.
think twice, I'm awkward when I speak. Ain't got the perfect smile, don't turn heads on my street. Trying to be a superstar like everybody else. But being myself is something I do well. Whatever you do, do it good. Whatever you do, 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 loud, loud, loud. Do it good, yeah. Alright, express yourself. I don't make the papers, I'm far from JLS. Ain't got the X factor, I'm not what they expect. But it won't be long before my turn is next to express. Now with all due respect, see whatever I do, I do it good. So whatever you do, 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 loud, loud, loud. Do it good.
And Anne Kobayashi's just got a short announcement to make for us.
Hello, sorry to butt in after such a nice video. This is just about something I saw on the internet. In this coming week, there's a very large group of Christians coming from South Korea. They're going to be in London for 2 weeks. And it's being promoted by a Christian pastor in central London called Dr. Jonathan Oloyede. And basically, they're going out to all different churches to inspire the people there. But next Monday and Tuesday evening, that's the 15th and 16th of September, at 7 p.m., they're going to have prayer gatherings in the Emmanuel Centre at Marsham Street, at Westminster. So I just felt it would be very good to go. If anybody has time or is interested, it would be very nice to go there, even if we maybe can't do a lot, but we can at least maybe speak to some of the Korean Christians and make them aware of our presence in London. And they might go back to Korea and tell their friends in Korea, oh, you know what, we met these Reverend Moon's people in London. So it just might raise awareness of us. And so if anybody's interested, it would be great to go. Thank you.
Thank you, Tian. Korean Christians send out the, after America, the second most amount of missionaries into the world. It's quite astounding for a country where Christianity is sort of 150 years old or something like that. And now we're going to hear from another Korean gentleman, Reverend Samuel Moon. So we've got the reading for today. There's a sermon. I want to highlight today to this August gathering some of these great principles. But in a sense, it is like licking a peel of a watermelon. It is not possible for you to grasp in depth the philosophical implications so quickly. One needs to sincerely study the unification principle with time and prayer. If we do indeed live for eternity, then clearly our priorities in life need to be reorganized. Okay, so something to reflect about as the band leads us in a further prayer and contemplation.
Thank you, Robert. So we'll have a few more songs for us to sing and join together in before we hear a message today from our Pastor Simon. So please rise and we'll sing, I'll Never Leave You Anymore.
scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone.
Going to try and get a bit more air in here. I know some people are quite hot. Good morning. It's nice to see you. Hope you had a good summer. Hope it's not too much of a shock, sort of suddenly going into September. Want to talk about priorities today, how we make priorities in our life, how important it is simply to do that. And different circumstances present us all with different sets of choices of how we use our time, what we make use of our time for. And it really does depend a lot on where we are and what we're doing. When I was in holiday just only a week and a half ago in the southwest of France in a tiny little village that had a square that was 30 steps almost from the house we were staying in, that as you walked into that square, you felt like you were walking onto a film set. Even the post office wasn't allowed a yellow sign. It was just preserved. The church there, sort of 12th century church, originally a dungeon, later on turned into a church. Good kind of progression there. It was just idyllic. And there I was, staying with my parents, who were staying with some second cousins of my dad, who've got a house out there. They live near us in London, but out there they have a house. And my brother's family was there, my family was there, and there I am in the middle of the day thinking, well, do I want to walk the 30 paces to the homemade ice cream cafe in the square, or do I want to jump in the pool, or do I want to take Chirko for a coffee, or do we want to take the kids on a bike ride? And I thought, oh, I'm not used to these kind of choices. It was a bit bewildering. Excuse me, I've got a bit of a cold. So really tough decisions I was facing, yeah? I'm back home, and let's just say the decisions are very different every day. The responsibilities are very different. And it was very good, anyway, to be given all those very idyllic choices to make priorities out of. But in our lives, we all need to make priorities, right? To work them out clearly and thoughtfully. To know what to do in the moment. What is the most important thing to do in this moment? For example, right now, what's the most important thing for you to be doing? Yeah, maybe, yeah. It's something, if we look ahead, we're in the autumn now, if we look ahead to the start of a new academic year for many people, just to look ahead and give some time and thought to what are my priorities? Do I want to put some time aside, actually, to reflect and pray about the rest of this year? My hope is this morning that you can be encouraged to really do that. As we go into this harvest season of autumn, you can put that time aside to really think about what's important for your life over the next few months leading up to the end of the year. Just to make sure, to be clear in yourself that you are on the path that is best for you, that your path is one that you're able to walk with together with God, that it's not just one that you're walking on your own. That you have God by your side. And it's a path that you're clear also what the distractions are going to be on that path, that you're not going to let those things distract you, that you're not going to let the things that can distract you, you know, that tend to distract you personally, the things that tend to bend you away from what's good in your life, that you're not going to allow those things to do that to you. And when I think about making priorities, and I think it'll become clear I'm going to share a couple of stories with you in a moment, but it actually means being emotionally aware of, you know, what my needs are, but also having a spiritual life that allows us to get to the heart of the matter, to be aware of our emotions, but a spiritual life that allows you to get to the heart of the matter, what's really behind those emotions, what's really the deepest thing that you want to focus on. So I have two stories, and the first one is from the New Testament, and it's about such a circumstance. And actually this story, it's one story of something that happened 2,000 years ago in a little village outside Jerusalem. But I think this story in other forms at that time with Jesus happened probably many times. And I think as a faith community here, as unification, it's something that's happened in the history of our movement many, many times. And so as we go into this story, you can reflect on that. So I think we have it here. It's from Luke chapter 10, verse 38 to 42. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. Now, as you can probably, if you've read much of the Bible, you know that Jesus didn't tend to so much travel by himself, but he had these 12 other people with him. And probably they had other people with them, and And so it wasn't just like inviting a couple of people over for a cup of tea. It was a bit of a crowd. And so there she is, worrying about all these people coming into her house. But she came to him, to Jesus, and asked. And you can get maybe a sense of her tone of voice. Lord, don't you care that my sister, sitting there in front of you, has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me, he says. There's an exclamation mark there. I didn't put it in. Martha, Martha, Jesus answers, you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed. Few things are needed. Or indeed, he says, only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. So what's going on here? Now, it seems like Martha has been cast in a slightly negative light, would you say? Yeah. But you've got to remember who she is. She's this woman, probably a widow, who has invited Jesus into her home, not just Jesus, all his disciples, not that far from Jerusalem, at a time when, frankly speaking, he wasn't as popular, let's say, as he is today. Yeah, he's kind of persona non grata, someone that it was potentially could have been dangerous even to associate with. But she opens her house to him. So she has a generous heart, and she has a willing heart. And you could say she's rightfully concerned about all these people coming into her house, that she prepares everything properly. But her sister feels actually she needs to listen to what Jesus has to say, that his words are more important. That more important than getting all the food together and making it a very splendid occasion, just simply listening to what he has to say is crucial, because this might be just their one chance to listen. And I don't know if you've ever experienced that something you think's important should be done, and you see someone else doing something else, and that you're cross that they don't realize what you're doing is actually really much, much more important. Or maybe you've experienced it the other way around. Maybe you've been in a situation like Mary, doing something very simple as she is, just simply sitting there on the floor, looking like actually she's not doing very much at all. But knowing in your heart you're doing something really important. And other people who seem much busier and more hardworking and industrious around you look at you in a disparaging way and are cross that you're not getting involved in what they are doing. Yeah, anyone? And you can think also just for a moment about Jesus' response. It's, as always with his response, it's not politically correct or he doesn't try to be nice. He just says, look, he says, Martha, Martha. He repeats her name twice. He wants to sort of calm her down, but he also wants to tell her clearly that she's looking at things the wrong way. He doesn't just say, you're busy. He says, you're worried and upset about many things. And his message to Mary and to anyone else who was listening is, don't be worried. Don't be upset. I'm here to show you the way. And so I think for me, when we think about priorities, and we read that little passage from Reverend Moon's speech in 1995, just a few days before he held that big marriage blessing in Korea that I took part in with my wife, and it poured with rain. And in that, at the end of that little passage that Robert read, he said, if we live eternally, then we will have to rearrange all our priorities. So some of you here grew up believing in eternal life. some of you grew up believing in spiritual life and it being just a sort of normal part of your family life. But for I know for some of us here, it was something that we only stumbled across. Maybe when we were 19 or 20, for me it was when I was 21 and I was introduced into the idea that actually after this life, the one that our elder brother Roy has just finished, that there is an eternal one, a life in the spirit world, in hopefully in heaven with, together with God and with all the other people who pass on. And that one fact was probably the most deciding fact that got me to rearrange so many of my priorities. And I think it's every time I take part, and if you're coming next Saturday to Roy's ascension ceremony, his Sunghwa, every time I take part in one of those ceremonies, it's one of those moments that defining moments for me, because I'm reminded again so clearly about that fact that all those years ago when I was 21 that got me to rearrange my priorities. and really that's what Jesus is trying to get Martha to do, to be less busy and less flappy and less worried about everything else and just focus on what's really important. He's got something to share, and actually it would be really good if she just sat down for a minute and listened. And I've got my second story is not quite as sort of, doesn't have such a religious context. It's basically about me driving a French car in France, which two things put together is a bit of a nightmare. So there was one moment in France really that really got me to focus my mind on this holiday. And later on in the day after it had happened, it got me thinking about, you know, how do all of us as a community, as individuals in a community, work out our own priorities and learn to deal with distractions. So I'm hurtling down the D122 from somewhere south of Bordeaux, back up towards Bordeaux, but a little bit to the right of it and beyond it, to a little village called Lussac. How's that, Betty? Or maybe I should ask your mum. We've had this lovely time in my parents' relative's house, and everyone else is going back to London, but we wanted to go to the annual gathering, and Damon and the other and Lenny had been at the Heart Workshop, so we had a couple more days. We came late. And so we were going to stay in a little bed and breakfast chateau thing in Lussac. My parents had a bit of time to kill, so they were coming with us. We were going in convoy. I had my dad next to me with the map. We did have a sat-nav, and we had got it into English, but it offered us too many Lussacs, none of which really looked like our one, and so we weren't relying on that. And my mum was driving in the car behind with Chirko and a couple of the kids, and some of them were me and my dad. It's quite a disturbing thing when you're driving a new car that you've never driven before, but you're sitting in the passenger seat, what should be the passenger seat, on the left-hand drive, also on the wrong side of the road. And the fact that it's a new car, and new cars tend to always try and have more stuff in them than old cars, and so every time you hire a car and it's a new one, you realize they're always inventing new things to put on the dashboard. And there was about 7 different levers coming out from the steering wheel. And there was a whole array of red figures and little diagrams on the dashboard. And there was a lot of bleeping going on, which I only found out later was every time someone took out their seatbelt, it would start bleeping, but I only found that out later. I had no idea what was bleeping away, and it's very hard when you're in the wrong seat on the wrong side of the road to have a sense of proportion. You're used to looking in out of a certain wing mirror, but you're having to look out of the other wing mirror, and to get that kind of distance between the oncoming traffic on your left and the grassy ditch on your right, on a small road is quite nerve-wracking. And and I caught a cold as a consequence. And so it struck me that I had to prioritize. I had to just forget about all the different levers. I knew which one was the indicator, and that's the one I needed to concentrate on. I didn't need to worry about the others. It wasn't going to rain. And I had to forget about all the bleeps and all the other things the dashboard was telling me and just make sure I didn't go into the oncoming traffic. And I didn't go into the grassy ditch on the side. And I didn't turn left onto the roundabout because I'm in France and I have to turn right onto the roundabout. If I turn left onto the roundabout, I'm going to kill my family. And so I realized I just got to focus on being safe and getting us from A to B. And so that's what I did, and we got there. I'll tell you more about that in a minute. But I'm sure you've all been in intense circumstances that, because they're intense, force you to narrow down what is really the priority in your life. And so you may not be facing an intense situation right now in your life, or you may be, but you know that. But when you do get faced with intense circumstances, don't complain about them, but realize that they're an opportunity to really know and figure out what is most important. It's a chance to get rid of distractions. And and you know, I realize I'm leading this convoy. There's two cars, and I'm driving the lead car. I'm in this position actually to lead. Oh, thanks, Cass. Cheers. To lead, and that's something I also thought about after, is that all of us, in our own unique and own personal way, are leading in our lives something. Because of our different abilities and our different strengths and our different circumstances, depending on where we're working or our family situation or different responsibilities that we take on, either in our community or out there in society. And it's so important when you're leading anything to know really what the priority is. Otherwise, you'll find it really hard to lead well, to lead yourself, to lead your family or a team or anything else. And I realized it's also been, as I know many of you feel you are, part of a providence of God, part of a plan that God has for this world that's, you know, a bit new, that's to do with God wanting to bring a new order into the world, a new culture that's different from the way things maybe were in the past. That there's some similarities there with driving a French car in France on the wrong side of the road when you're English. It feels like you'd sometimes having to learn something very new, very quickly. It doesn't always feel like it comes completely naturally. You have to concentrate a lot to make sure you don't, like I said, turn left on to a roundabout. And in that situation, as some of you feel you are, you need to think what it is that needs to be prioritized. So from time to time, I just want to encourage you just to think about what are the less important things and what are the more important things. What's the most important thing for you to get you from A to B? Where is it that you're trying to get yourself to? How are you going to make sure that you don't veer off into the oncoming traffic and hit a big French juggernaut or slide off into the grassy ditch and mash up the car? in your life. I mean, I hope that doesn't sound too dramatic. But sometimes it feels like that when you've got big choices or difficult situations. And just to conclude, a great way to work out core priorities is actually to do what with the future? What do you think? When you think about making priorities, what do you think? If you're making priorities for the future, what's a good thing to do? Yeah. Planning is a brilliant way to work out what your priorities are, because you're looking at where you want to be. You're trying to think of a picture of how you'd like your life to look like, say, in 3 years' time. And, well, to do that, you start to quickly think, well, what's important for me to do now, and what will be important next year? And actually, when we do this, we find sometimes our priorities shift a bit. We rearrange our priorities a bit, because actually where I want to be in 3 years is very, very different from where I am now. So that means I'm going to have different priorities coming up in my life, maybe different from the ones I have now that seem to apply to my current picture. And so I know I've spoken about this a couple of times. I did this about a year ago, year and a half ago, and I'm not the greatest planner, so I'm not going to give a sermon on planning necessarily, but I experienced how much just taking time to plan the next few years of my life shifted my priorities and my perspective on what was really important. One of them was that how much we need a much more shared sense of leadership in our community, and I won't go into all of that now, but another time. But what are the milestones that you want in the next 3 years of your life? What priorities would you have to have to reach those milestones? Are they financial? Are they to do with a relationship? How much underneath whatever outwardly you want to do, is there a sense of a spiritual priority? What does it mean, actually, to have spiritual priority? Does it mean, what does spiritual life really mean to you? Is it what everyone else says it is, or have you really found a way to describe it personally to yourself in your heart, your spiritual life? But anyway, you're all wondering, no you're not, but anyway, I'm going to tell you anyway, eventually we did arrive at Lusak. But of course, where we were staying wasn't actually in Lusak. It was just one of those places outside, one of those little country lanes that definitely wasn't on the sat-nav and definitely wasn't on the map either. But, there's something about a journey when you've really been on it for a while, when you've persevered and you've focused as I did and not gone into the ditch or left on the roundabout, that when you get close to what was for us our home for the next 2 days, when you get close to your destination, there's something actually that propels you forward. There's something beyond you, there's something above you, there's something greater that tends to help that momentum continue and get you to where you, even though you can't, we weren't exactly sure where it was, and often in life we're not exactly sure what it is, but if we've worked out quite a lot of the journey and we've at least had a good sense of what it is, that God gets us that final mile. And in our case, it was just a matter of answering lots of French people out of the car window and kept continuing to drive around till my sharp eyes spotted the little tiny sign hidden in a hedge. So I just want to say that as you continue on your path towards whatever it is you're hoping to get to, in this year or over the next 3 years, whatever your picture is of God's kingdom for your life over these years, that if you have an ability to prioritize and focus, have confidence that you will get there and God will bring you that final mile, because he wants you to get there even more than you do. And that's an important thing to remember. So I just want to finish there, and I'll just say a prayer, and like we do, just want us to take some time, either to pray with someone next to you and share about what your priorities are, or if you want to just take a quiet moment by yourself, that's also okay, just to pray by yourself. But if you feel like praying with someone else, don't feel shy to ask someone to pray with you, and just invite the band up to play some worship music for us to support our prayer, and let's bring God's Spirit into this room for our prayer. And Father, we come before you as our parent, and you love each person here so much, and you want us to get to where we're trying to get to. We pray that in this week ahead, we can all take some time to think about what our priorities are, that maybe we've finished our holiday and we've realized how many responsibilities we have, and it's a bit of a shock coming back home from holiday or from the summer, and therefore it's a good time to think, what do we really want to focus on? And I just ask you to speak to each heart in this room and hear the prayers that people offer up to you. Pray these things in our name, to pray in your name, Father, for this and that. So let's pray together, and the band will play for us.
Now we'll have our offering song, 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name.
Please rise and sing.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name.
Of offering prayer, ceremony prayer. Good morning, dearest Heavenly Parent, true parents. Thank you so much for giving us this time to come together at the end of the week or the beginning of the week to listen to our sermon today, which was about prioritizing. Father, we want to really just take this moment to reflect the week, and we all know that deep down we understand what is the most important things are in our lives. So we want to really refocus and be mindful each day for the coming week. So please continue to be together with us, and we want to offer this offering to you today, which is a fruit of our labor. I hope you can accept it, and I'd like to now offer this prayer up to you on behalf of all my brothers and sisters here, and I'm praying about this in my name, Tadahara Hashimoto, Central Blessed Family, Aju.
Okay, please be seated. Thank you, Tadahara. So what a lovely service we've had this morning, lovely worship, praising God, attending True Parents, hearing an entertaining sermon about France, and, always a great subject, and I hope you all have a lovely week, God bless you, and next week is home service, and all the information hopefully about the announcements is downstairs on the notice board, and if you have any questions, you can talk to Simon or myself, and we'll try and help you. Have a good week. Bye.